Good morning. Hear God's word from the book of Acts, chapter 2, verses 1 through 21. The Holy Spirit comes at Pentecost. When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Suddenly, a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. Now there were staying in Jerusalem God-fearing Jews from every nation under heaven. When they heard this sound, a crowd came together in bewilderment, because each one heard their own language being spoken. Utterly amazed, they asked, "Aren't all those who are speaking Galileans? Then how is it that each of us hears them in our native language? Parthians, Medes, and Elamites, residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya near Cyrene, visitors from Rome, both Jews and converts to Judaism, Cretans and Arabs, we hear them declaring the wonders of God in our own tongues." Amazed and perplexed, they asked one another, "What does this mean?" Some, however, made fun of them and said, "They have had too much wine." Then Peter stood up with the 11, raised his voice, and addressed the crowd. "Fellow Jews, and all of you who live in Jerusalem, let me explain this to you. Listen carefully to what I say. These people are not drunk, as you suppose. It's only 9 in the morning. No. This is what was spoken by the prophet Joel. In the last days, God says, I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your young men will see visions. Your old men will dream dreams. Even on my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days, and they will prophesy. I will show wonders in the heavens above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and billows of smoke. The sun will be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the great and glorious day of the Lord. And everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved." End of reading. Welcome, congregation. I invite you to rise this Sunday morning and lift your voices as we sing, "Come, People of the Risen King."
Come, people of the risen King, who delight to bring him praise. Come all and tune your hearts to sing to the morning star of grace. The shifting shadows of the earth, we will lift our eyes to him, where steady arms of mercy reach to gather children in. Rejoice, rejoice, let every tongue rejoice. One heart, one voice, O Church of Christ, rejoice. Joy is morning sun, and those weeping through the night. Come those who tell of battles won, and those struggling in the fight. For his perfect love will never change, and his mercies never cease, but follow us through all our days with
with the certain hope of peace. Shore to shore we hear them call, the truth that cries through every age, our God is all in all. Rejoice, rejoice, let every tongue rejoice, one heart, one voice, O Church of Christ, rejoice.
You may be seated. Praise God. Today is June 5th, 2022. It is Pentecost. Here we are, Church of the Lutheran Brethren, and we are called a disciple-making church. As we gather, we know and understand that we are people and a church called to follow Christ, shaped and sent under the Word. We are called to love, serve, reconcile, and connect our neighbors with Jesus, His community, and His mission. We are a people and a church that endeavors to foster the interdependence of individuals, congregations, regions, and synod in disciple-making to serve the great commission of our Lord. We understand that we are a people and a church engaged in the calling, empowering, and supporting of young men and women to lead in making disciples and in forming disciple-making communities. We are a people and a church passionate about mobilizing our people and congregations to disciple neighbors, both near and far, so that new churches are planted and established congregations are revitalized. We are a church of the Lutheran Brethren. This morning, we have some announcements, and I would like to begin with by inviting Peggy Smythe, for a few announcements.
Good morning. On behalf of the senior ministry, we would like to invite all of you to stay after church today for our ice cream social. Used to be an annual event, but COVID kind of interrupted that. So we have hot dogs and we have chili and ice cream, and other goodies. So please stay and enjoy that. Also want to announce that on June 26th, we will be honoring our graduates with a coffee fellowship in their honor. There's a sign-up sheet out in the foyer. So if you graduated from high school, college, tech school, please sign up and we will include your name in a flyer that Sunday in the bulletin. And then also, because of the state regulations during COVID, we weren't able to do this in 2020 or 2021. So if you graduated or in either of those years, we would like to include you in that flyer. Just put the date of your graduation, whether it was 2020 or 2021, and we too would love to honor you. It's such an accomplishment. We want to enjoy that celebration with you. So thank you. See you back in the fellowship hall.
Another announcement from Annie Summers this morning. Annie.
So when you work with children, you always have lots of stuff. And I'm getting ready to be gone for a short while, and we're still planning VBS, and it's going great. Everybody's pitching in as usual. But I wanted to just give you a couple ideas, because if you want to do something during the summer, I'm going to have Peggy informed on all of this, and she'll know where to find the things. But I have some little projects that need to be done. So the other day, I was looking for rocks for the kids to paint on. And I was getting down to where I might have to order them from Amazon for $50 for 70 rocks, because they needed to all be 2 or 3 inches in size and kind of similar. So at the dollar store, they were too small. But the dollar store lady told me to go to this landscaping supply place up the street. And I got 70 rocks free. And it wasn't hard to pick them out. I just picked them out of the drain rocks, but they need to be washed. There's always something, you know, they need to be washed. So if somebody wanted to wash those, they could just talk to me today or have Peggy give them whatever it needs to be done. This is black posters, and I need the mainland of Australia as big on these posters as I can get it for a silhouette of the continent. I have 2 poster boards to do that on. I have some little baby dolls that need little towels and washcloths because they're going to wash them. And some of them, 4 of them, came without any diapers or bottoms, so I need somebody who will make little diapers or panties for a few dolls. And there's just things like that that are extra that happen. And we also need somebody to find all those little doctor kit things, like the stethoscope, the play ones, that we're going to have a little doctor's office where the kids get to be doctors, you know, with the reception area and exam table. And we're going to need the little toy doctor things. So somebody could start looking for those. And so those are just some of the ideas. There's other things too, but I just wanted to let you know, if you want to have something to do this summer, just talk to Peggy or me, and then I'll pick it up back in August when I get back, and we'll go from there too. But we have plenty of time. And I want to thank everybody for all the work that you're doing to help.
Thank you, Annie. We also have an announcement from Elder Fred Erickson this morning.
Good morning. My name is Fred Erickson. I'm an elder, and since May 1st, I was elected chairman of the congregation, so I'm reporting to you on that, in that role, that function. We have congregational meetings, official ones, twice a year. Sometimes we need them more than that. And this report I'm giving you today is a follow-up from our May 1st meeting, which was supposed to be in April. But we've been off schedule for a few years now because of COVID restrictions, and now we're trying to get everything rebooted. So I'm reporting to you based on a motion that was made and passed by the congregation on May 1st, putting us on the church council, the elders and the pastor, under the gun to come up with a list of appointees for this coming year. And it's not a calendar year. This is a year from church council meeting in April to, congregational meeting in April to the next year's meeting. And here are the appointed positions so far. We have one or two question marks, but most have been filled. And I'm very thankful for all those who have accepted positions to serve our congregation. People who have stepped up to the plate and actually have soldiered on through the whole COVID thing and continued to serve. So I especially appreciate our trustees. And we staggered our appointments. The trustees served for just 3 years, and we had people on the trustee board that had served the last 3 years and the 3 years before that, and so we staggered the terms. So the following were appointed for 1 year, and they accepted. Mike Schaefer, and actually, let's see, where's Mike? Actually, he's up in the balcony. There he is, up there. Everybody can wave to him in just a second here. And actually, when I call your name, I'll ask you to stand. John Stevens, John here, is for 1 year. Now and then we also have for 2 years, Scott Hines. Scott is here, there he is. Have him stand, thank you, Scott. Tim Hovind has accepted for a 3 year position. Tim and Corky here, no. And then Dennis Millett over here for 3 years. Thank you, Dennis, for agreeing to serve again. And then Roy Hegland is coming back on board for a 3 year term. Where is he? There he is back there, the tall guy. So thank you, trustees, appreciate it. Stay standing for just a little longer. And here's the fall other additional appointed positions. As treasurer, Val Pote, our perennial treasurer, who's actually an institution in the church. As financial secretary, Dave George. I know Dave is here. There he's back there. And children's ministry coordinator. It continues until next fall or something. It'll be Annie Summers. Thank you, Annie. Stand up, Annie. You can leave your bag on the pew. Okay. Annie Summers. Then a new position, Sunday school coordinator, kind of works with children's ministries, is Diana Ramos. So Mrs. Ramos, here she is. Then we have, yes, thank you, Diana. Dave George, again, continuing to serve as head usher. Then we have, we're starting a new tradition. We're starting a new life to an old tradition, the Easter breakfast. And our Easter breakfast coordinator, at his own suggestion, Mr. Mario Doiron, Mario stands, and his assistant, who just officially agreed this morning, will be Roy Hegland. I'm not sure which of those guys will be in charge, but we'll wait and see. Coffee Fellowship coordinator, Val Pote, said yes to that, bless your heart. Lead sound technician, the ever-versatile Mike Schaefer has agreed to that, but we're going to try to get some help going his direction. Women's Ministry Chairwoman, Lori Turrell. Lori, are you here? Oh, they're gone this weekend. Yeah, so is Mike Starr, actually. Then our MUG coordinator, Dave George, who reminded me this morning that men's prayer breakfast is next weekend. Let's see, Bible Scholarship Coordinator, Debbie Erickson, who's been pretty busy. Go ahead, and you have to stand, Mrs. Erickson. There she goes. There she is. And the We have an interior decor team, and so far I think they're all willing to serve again. And that's Michelle, Sarah, and Angela right now, and there might be a fourth added, but well, thank you guys. The church looks great. Let's give these folks a hand. Keep them standing. And I'd like to lead in prayer. Heavenly Father, bless those who have agreed to serve for another year, another 2 years, another 3 years. I ask your grace upon them as they assume these leadership roles, as they take responsibility. May they find the help they need from within the congregation and from you in serving in these roles. We ask this in Jesus' name, that your word may be promulgated and the gospel may be preached. In Jesus' name, amen. You may sit down, you guys. And if you're here this morning and not a member, but you know the Lord Jesus Christ personally as your Savior, we have application forms. You can apply for membership. Then you get to vote on stuff like this. And we keep our meetings to like 20 minutes, unless it goes longer. But we try to keep them short. So thank you, all of you members, for your faithfulness. And also, if you're here and you're coming to us from another LB church, we invite you to transfer membership here and take part. So God bless you guys. Thank you.
Oh, we might have our fill of announcements this morning, but I have just a few more things. Our June calendar is available at the entrance. Pick up a June calendar. It will list all the events going on here at Word of Life for the month of June. Along with that, you'll see our daily prayer notes. Daily prayer notes, we put this out once a month. This is the month of June. It's a good way to keep up with those out in the mission field. You could partner in the work of the Lutheran Brethren International Mission by praying for the missionaries. There's a short daily prayer listed. And the missionaries are with the LBIM. We'll be praying for the folks who are called and sent out to places like Chad, Taiwan, and Japan. So join with us in praying for the missionaries. To that end, we also have a short glimpse of the work these missionaries are doing. Do we have that video to play?
There are 72 unreached people groups in Chad, people groups that don't have a church in their own cultural context.
So what you have is people who are living and dying every day within the context of a people group or a tribe, and they never hear the gospel.
The Lutheran Brethren has been working in Chad since the 1920s, planting a church that has grown much larger than our church in North America.
That church is very culturally relevant to the people groups in Chad where that church was planted, which are very different than the people groups that we're trying to reach. That church was planted in the context of animist tribes. And the mission that we're trying to do is focused on Muslim people groups. And so the culture of the Muslims in Chad is very different than the culture of the former animists in Chad who have become believers. And so those two peoples don't intermingle.
Lutheran Brethren International Mission has been called to work with three Muslim people groups, the Bagirmi, the Balala, and the Fulbe. These unreached people groups have essentially no way to hear the gospel in their language and culture.
Even though there might be a church in the next town, if they go to that church, they're going to a church where the culture is very different than their own, the language is very different than their own, the way they worship in terms of the form of worship that that church takes is very different than what they would be feeling comfortable with. A Balala comes to faith and they have nowhere to go to worship their Lord and Savior in their own heart language. The challenge then for the mission, as we plant churches among these people groups, is to help and facilitate a church plant that is culturally relevant so that they can hear the gospel in the context of their own culture and in their own language.
Qu'il fallait beaucoup prier pour ce peuple. Prier aussi dans chaque domaine pour que les missionnaires qui vont s'installer parmi ce peuple aient la possibilité de témoigner Christ à ces gens.
Well, Well, it is time for our scripture reading this morning. We will be reading from Genesis chapter 11, verses 1 through 9. And for that, I would like to invite up our elder, Howard Aandahl. Howard?
Good morning, good morning. This morning we will be reading from Genesis 11, verses 1 through 9. Now the whole earth had one language and the same words, and the people migrated from the east. They found a plain in the land of Shinar and settled there. And they said to one another, "Come, let us make bricks and burn them thoroughly." And they had brick for stone and bitumen for mortar. And they said, "Come, let us build ourselves a city and a tower with its top in the heavens, and let us make a name for ourselves, lest we be dispersed over the face of the whole earth." And the Lord came down to see the city and the tower which the children of man had built. And the Lord said, "Behold, they are one people and have one language, and this is only the beginning of what they will do. And nothing that they propose to do will now be impossible for them. Come, let us go down and there confuse their language, so that they may not understand one another's speech." So the Lord dispersed them from there over the face of all the earth, and they left off building the city. Therefore, its name was called Babel, because there the Lord confused the language of all the earth. And from there, the Lord dispersed them over the face of the earth. End of reading.
Congregation, let us rise once more as we sing praises to the Lord. We'll sing, "All Things Are Possible."
From you alone, my Lord and my salvation. Your praise is always on my lips. Your word is living in my heart, and I will praise you with a new song.
My soul will bless you, Lord. You fill my life with greater joy.
Yes, I delight myself in you, and I will praise you with a new song.
My soul will bless you, Lord. My feet are planted on this rock, and I will not be shaken. My hope, it comes from you alone, my Lord and my salvation.
Delight myself.
possible. All things are possible. All things are possible. All things are possible. Your praise is always on my lips. Your word is living in my heart. And I will praise you with a new song. My soul will bless you, Lord. You fill my life with greater joy. Yes, I delight myself in you. And I will praise you with a new song. My soul will bless you, Lord. When I am weak, you make me strong. When I'm poor, I know I'm rich, for in the power of your name. All things are possible. All things are possible. Possible. All things are possible. Lord, the light of your love is shining in the midst of the darkness, shining. Jesus, light of the world, shine upon us. Set us free by the truth you now bring us. Shine on me. Shine on me. Shine, Jesus, shine. Fill this land with the Father's glory. Blaze, Spirit, blaze. Set our hearts on fire. Flow. To your awesome presence, from the shadows into your radiance. By the blood I may enter your brightness. Search me, try me, consume all my darkness. Shine on me. Shine on me. Shine.
Congregation, please be seated. Well, it's time to pray. Would you join in and pray with me? Let's pray together. Gracious Heavenly Father, your Spirit fills the world and gladdens your church. As we remember all Christ Jesus has spoken, we ask that you comfort us with the peace that only you can give. And do not let our hearts be troubled or afraid. We ask you for courage in these times, for boldness. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We lift up the missionaries, as they're called, and living as people who are sent. We want to pray for the church in Chad as they're searching for new families to be missionary candidates. We pray for couples of good character and humility to contribute to the community in Chad. We lift up all the needs of those who are living as people who are sent in foreign countries who are called by you, Lord, that you would continue to equip them, to continue to provide for them, and give them the words to speak. Help them to be your hands and your feet as they reach out to the lost with your word, Lord, and your word is truth. Lord, we want to pray for the children. We lift up the children today. We're going to bless these children, Lord, each day. They're a blessing to us. And we know that you have poured out your spirit upon them, Lord. And they've been baptized and washed. Lord, we ask that you would allow us to raise these sons and daughters in your word. May they grow in your truth. We ask that you would bless all parents and caregivers and caretakers of these children, that they may faithfully teach the children your word. We ask all these things in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Our message this morning is from the Gospel of John, chapter 14, verses 23 through 31. That's the section of gospel we will read today. But I included an extra verse. We're going to start at verse 22. Verse 22 contains a question, and the rest of it is the answer. So I wanted to include that question in verse 22. So we'll read John 14, 22 through 31. Reading from the gospel. Judas, not Iscariot, said to him, "Lord, how is it that you will manifest yourself to us and not to the world?" Jesus answered him, "If anyone loves me, he will keep my word, and my Father will love him, and we will come to him and make our home with him. Whoever does not love me does not keep my words, and the word that you hear is not mine, but the Father's who sent me. These things I have spoken to you while I am still with you. But the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all that I have said to you. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. Not as the world gives do I give to you. Let not your hearts be troubled. Neither let them be afraid. You heard me say to you, I am going away, and I will come to you. If you loved me, you would have rejoiced, because I am going to the Father, for the Father is greater than I. And now I have told you, before it takes place, so that when it does take place, you may believe. I will no longer talk much with you, for the ruler of this world is coming. He has no claim on me, but I do as the Father has commanded, so that the world may know that I love the Father. Rise, let us go from here." End of reading the Gospel of our Lord from John chapter 14. Jesus telling his disciples in advance, "I am going away, and I will come to you." This going and this coming revealed to the disciples. Jesus here in the flesh, Jesus with us, this gift of God with us. But now Jesus telling his disciples that he's going away. Well, you know, since I've been here, since you guys called us here, our family has been very blessed to be here to share our time with you each Sunday and during the week, to connect with you, to get to know you a little bit in these almost half of a year that we've been here now. Time really does fly. But since I've been here, each week, each Sunday, we've been hearing the Gospels read. You've been hearing the Gospel preached. Beginning at Advent, when I started, we started with Advent through Christmas, through Easter, and now the day of Pentecost. Today is the day of Pentecost. And we've been tracking along with Jesus through the Gospels that we hear each week. And each week, this word is presented before you, and you hear about the person and work of Jesus Christ. And today, the day of Pentecost, this is a work of God, a day where we see God in action, working for us, helping us, right? The day of Pentecost. Pentecost is 50 days after Easter. The Pentecost actually means 50. It's a Greek origin, Pentecost 50. The Pentecostals then are what, 50s? No, they're not. But Pentecost is a spirit focus, right? And we have the Word and the Spirit. What's it all about to be baptized with the Holy Spirit? This baptism of the Holy Spirit. It's a prophetic thing. It's something God had planned long ago and spoke from the mouth of the prophets of His Spirit being poured out on all flesh. Not the first time that the Holy Spirit is on the earth. We see Him from the very beginning in Genesis at creation. The Spirit of the Lord hovered over the waters. And we see various times when the Holy Spirit would indwell and fill people and show up in the Old Testament. But here's something different, this gift of the Holy Spirit poured out on all flesh, on all nations, on all peoples. Pentecost. Well, Jesus spoke in Acts, in the book of Acts chapter 1, verse 4. While they were together, while the disciples and Jesus were together, Jesus commanded them. He says, "Do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift." The gift the Father promised, which you have heard me discuss. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. So when the day of Pentecost came, you'll find that in Acts chapter 2. When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. And suddenly, a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. The day of Pentecost, the account given in Acts chapter 2. And we remember that day today. But you'll notice in Acts chapter 2 how that verse begins. It says, Acts chapter 2, verse 1, when the day of Pentecost came. So the day of Pentecost comes, it was already a biblical holy day. And that's why there were pilgrims in Jerusalem that day. That's why there were so many peoples, Parthians, Medes, Elamites. They were all in Jerusalem for the day of Pentecost. But as they understood it in the Old Testament context, people from all over the known world, it was already a set-apart time. It was a biblical holy day ordained in the Torah of Moses, the first five books of our Bible. It's the day of Pentecost. In Greek, it's called Pentecost. In Hebrew, they call it Shavuot. Shavuot. It's the festival of weeks. Festival of weeks. 7 weeks, right? 7 weeks. Shavuot is celebrated 7 weeks after Passover in the Old Testament. You'll read about it in the Torah. And in Deuteronomy 16, for example. Deuteronomy 16 says, 3 times a year all your men must appear before the Lord your God at the place He will choose. For the festival of unleavened bread, for the festival of weeks, that's Shavuot, Pentecost, and for the festival of tabernacles. No one should appear before the Lord empty-handed. Each of you must bring a gift in proportion to the way the Lord your God has blessed you. That's the law of Moses, speaking about the Festival of Weeks. Reading from Deuteronomy 16, mentioning this Festival of Weeks, Pentecost. And now on this day, 7 weeks from Passover, 7 weeks since Jesus' dying and rising, we hear about a gift. A gift is presented. In the Torah, in the Old Testament, the people, you, everyone must present a gift to the Lord according to how they were blessed. Here, God presents us with the ultimate gift. A gift. We read under the law that people brought a gift. Here, the gospel is given. This gospel gift is given to us on Pentecost. Jesus says, "Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you." And we have to absorb that. This is God's peace given to you. And it's not as the world gives. So we think of peace as maybe a blissful state, a momentary time of relaxation. But Jesus says, not as the world gives. Jesus says, "Let not your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid." God's peace is a gift that he suffered and died to give you. It's not as the world gives. It's not merely a blissful and momentary state. It's not merely relaxation. The world can provide relaxation. It's not merely letting go. It's peace from God and peace with God. We were separated from God because of our sins, the fall of man. This separation from God. And God's been working. All throughout the scriptures, we see how God has been working with his covenant people, with his called out people, ultimately with and through Jesus Christ to provide salvation to us, to make us right. God made us right with Jesus' dying and rising. Now his spirit can dwell among us until Jesus' return. We have God's abiding presence, this gift, the indwelling of our God with us, in us, through us, working, living abundantly. Jesus said, "If anyone loves me, he will keep my word, and my Father will love him, and we will come to him and make our home with him." So you are the person with the Spirit of the Lord and all the fullness of the triune God that we worship. Listed here in this scripture, Jesus says, "The Father will send the Holy Spirit in my name." In our passage, we have the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit revealed in fullness, in a new way. The word of Jesus given to us, this gift. Not a God that you just hear about, but the God that indwells you. You keep his word. You treasure his word. You guard his word. And his life is lived in and through you. Jesus tells his disciples that he's going. So we know that with Jesus in our midst, it was Emmanuel. God is with us. We celebrate at Christmas the incarnation. Jesus is with us. And we knew God in the flesh, according to the flesh, as a person. But he tells his disciples that he's going. And the Holy Spirit will come. And the Holy Spirit will teach them all things to write down, to record, to give us these gospels that we read and hear each week. We can trust the gospels because they were ordained by God. This word was given by God through his apostles, through his messengers. So we could pick up and read this spirit-inspired word. You see the mingling of word and spirit. Spirit and truth. And that is how we live as people of the word and of the spirit. The Holy Spirit comes. And notice Jesus says, "The Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name." We think of God as our ever-present help. The word helper is a paraclete. In the Greek, paraclete could be translated helper, could be translated comforter, could be translated advocate. He's your advocate. He's the one you can turn to who has your back, who comforts you in all your affliction, who helps you in your time of need. God provides all these things. He is our guide. He is the one who leads us. He fills us with joy and peace. How? How is he manifest to us and not to the world? Jesus says, by those who keep my word, by keeping his word, by guarding his word, by treasuring his word, we hear each week the word of Jesus, the message of the gospel. This word is a twofold word. It contains both law and gospel. We learn about our sinful state. We hear convicting words that make us and call us to turn from sin and turn to life and living this baptized life, a daily baptism where we keep turning to God, keep walking in his ways, pressing on in the Lord, walking in the Spirit. We live in this tension where there's a mind of the flesh and yet a mind of the Spirit. We have to put on our Lord Jesus Christ, walk in the Spirit, walk in his ways, keep his word, guard it and treasure his word, walk in the fullness and the newness of life. The Helper, the Holy Spirit with us. It's not something that you have to feel, but something you have to believe, because God's word says it. Jesus promised it. It's in your Bible. God sent the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost to fill all believers. The Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name. And we see this life, our life, can be lived in Christ. God calls us to himself. We're not following God who's far off and distant, unreachable, unknowable. Our God has made himself known to us. He has given us and provided for us every good thing for our salvation, so that we can be Spirit-filled believers, that we can be Word-based believers, the Word and the Spirit working together. Judas, in chapter 14, verse 22, Judas asks, and John is careful to tell us, this is not Judas Iscariot, this is the other Judas. John 14, 22, Judas, not Iscariot, said to him, Lord, how is it that you will manifest yourself to us and not to the world? Who keeps the word of the Lord? How is it? Jesus said, if anyone loves me, he will keep my word, and my Father will love him, and will come to him, and make our home with him. Let me ask you today, treasuring the word of the Lord, are we abiding in Jesus, abiding in his word, living the life in the Spirit, where everything is given as a gift to us, our life, as a gift provided? Jesus says, keep my word, and my Father will love you, and we will come to you and make our home with you. This is the gift provided on Pentecost. This is the work that Jesus finished for us in his dying and rising. It is for your benefit that Jesus went away, for the Holy Spirit was sent from the Father and the Son. And we can be worshipers in spirit and in truth. Congregation, let's pray. Almighty Father, on this Pentecost, on this Sunday, we recall the mighty deeds of the salvation that you provided for us through your Son, Jesus Christ. You saved us, you justified us, you made us right, and you sent us your Holy Spirit into our lives through your word to rule and govern us according to your will. We ask that you would comfort us in every temptation. Lord, help us in our misfortune. Comfort us when we have no strength. Defend us, Lord, against every error. May we continue steadfast, Lord, in the faith. May we increase in love. May we increase in good works. May we walk in your ways, Lord. May we trust in you firmly. May we take hold of your grace, Lord. May we keep your word and treasure it and store it up and live by your word in your Holy Spirit. We trust firmly in your grace. And may we obtain eternal salvation through Jesus Christ, your Son and our Lord, who lives and reigns with you, Father, and the Holy Spirit, one God now and forever. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Congregation, we shall rise for our closing song this morning. Wonderful, merciful Savior.
Wonderful, merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and friend. Who would have thought that a lamb could rescue the souls of men? Comforter, keeper, spirit we long to embrace. You offer hope when our hearts have hopelessly lost the way. Oh, we hopelessly lost the way.
Everyone, please receive this blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his face upon you and give you peace. Amen. Go in peace.